What follows is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, second chapter, text number 51 to 54, given by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in the summer of 1966 in New York.
Karmajam buddhi yukta hi phalam tatta manishina janmabandha vininmukta padam gacchanti anamayam. Now, in our last meeting, we were discussing this verse that karmajam, every activity that we are engaged in, it has got a reaction. Any activity, it has got reaction, and that reaction is another bondage for me. Now I am engaged in one action and I am producing another reaction. Now at the present moment I am bounded by one kind of activity and I am producing another kind of activity. Just like in the cinematographic spool, there are hundreds and thousands of pictures. One picture past, another picture present, and another picture is ahead. And the whole picture, when put into the machine, it represents some activity. So we are bound up by nature's law in such a way. While nature's law, even in your state laws, we are bound up by so many laws. So this is our position. This is called conditioned stage of life. There is no freedom. The so-called freedom, we declare that I belong to the free nation, I am free. These are all simply mental speculation. There is no freedom. So long I am bound up by the conditions of nature, there is no freedom. Now, here is a chance. Lord Krishna says that karmajang buddhi yukta. Now, here is an opportunity for you in human form of your life. You have got sufficient intelligence and the Lord Himself is before you to enlighten your intelligence more and more. Here is the book. This book, what is spoken by Lord Krishna and Krishna, is not different, because the Krishna or the Lord is on the absolute plane. Don't think that Krishna is absent. Krishna is present here. There is a verse in Bhagavata. Tattva tishthami narada yatra gayanti madhukta. My dear Narada is a great devotee. Perhaps you who are accustomed with Vedic literature, you have heard the name of Narada. So Narada is a great devotee and the Lord assured him that don't think that I am living in the kingdom of God or I am living in the heart of a great mystic or somewhere else people may think. But I am living in that place where my sincere devotees assemble and discuss about myself. So, here we should always understand that if we sincerely and seriously take up the message of the Bhagavad Gita as it is, without any, adulteration. Sometimes it is adulterated because Bhagavad Gita is a very authoritative book and it is popular all over the world. Sometimes people take advantage of this book and present their own theory in an adulterated way. Not to speak of others. I may tell you frankly that in our country, the greatest, saintly politician, Mahatma Gandhi, he propounded a philosophy of non-violence. Perhaps you know, every one of you, that he propounded non-violence. And he wanted to prove non-violence from Bhagavad Gita. He has got an annotation of Bhagavad Gita and he has tried to prove that Bhagavad Gita, there is a proof, non-violence. But actually, Bhagavad Gita is being spoken in the battlefield where everyone is prepared to start violence. Simply for a moment, when Arjuna was disturbed in his mind that how can I fight with my relatives and friends and sons and grandsons and so many things, bodily relations, and the Bhagavad Gita was spoken. So, that is a practical thing, that Bhagavad Gita was practically spoken to induce Arjuna to adopt that. Now, Mahatma Gandhi, his philosophy was non-violence. How could he prove that Bhagavad Gita gives evidence of non-violence? No. Therefore, anyone, Mahatma Gandhi or anyone, who has got his own ulterior motive to prove it from the topics of Bhagavad Gita, he must adulterate it. But that is not the process of reading Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita, how to read Bhagavad Gita, that is stated in the Bhagavad Gita. When we come to the fourth chapter, we'll know. So anyway, apart from the process of, but rest assured, we are speaking here of the Bhagavad Gita as it is. We are not going to add in it something for fulfilling our own philosophy, our own points of view. Now, here Lord Krishna says that if you want to get rid of this entanglement, what is that entanglement? Janma bandha. It is a great entanglement. People do not take it very seriously. Birth means, as soon as birth only, the one word has been used here, janma. Janma means birth. The birth means other things. Birth means death. Birth means old age. Birth means disease. Whenever there is birth, the other things are corollary. They will follow. Your birth means a son is born. You are very glad I have got a son. But if you study philosophically, no, birth is not, he is not born, death is born. Because the growing of the child means he is dying. It is dying. The dying process. The very day, the very moment the child is born, the dying process begins. So we do not know that it is not birth, it is death. This is called Maya. This is called illusion. That death is born and we are jolly that there is birth of the child. This is called Maya. So everything, from the beginning of our birth, we are illusion. Illusion. And that illusion is so strong that it is very difficult to get out of it. Whole thing is illusion. The birth is illusion, this body is illusion, and the bodily relationship, the country is illusion, the father is illusion, the mother is illusion, the wife is illusion, the children is illusion. Everything illusion. Everything illusion. And we are compact in that illusion. We are thinking that we are very much learned and very much advanced and so many things we are imagining. But as soon as death comes, the actual fact, the beginning of death, then we forget everything. We can forget our country, we forget our relatives, we forget our wife, children, father, mother, everything gone. You see? If it is a fact that I am soul, eternal, then it is a fact also that in my previous life I had my country, I had my children, I had my home, I had my father, I had my everything. But can you remember any of these things, what you were in your previous life, either human born life or either animal life? You cannot. Death means forgetful. We have forgotten everything. Actually, there is no death for the soul. Just like you are at night, you go to sleep. So that is a sort of death. And again, you get up in the morning. So death is something like that. Death is sleeping for 7 months, that's all. Without any consciousness, for three months without any consciousness. Or say 7 months. Death means forgetfulness. Just like at sleep, we forget everything. What I am, where I am sleeping, who I am, what is my identification, everything forgot. Then again, as soon as I rise up in the morning, I remember, I am such and such officer, I am such and such father, such and such husband, and I have got to do such and such things. Everything remembered. But during your sleep, you forget everything. Similarly, death means from the time of your leaving this body and entering into the womb of another mother, and so long as the body is not developed, you remain unconscious. And as soon as another body is developed within the womb of the mother and the time is up to come out, then again you remember. So practically, there is no death. Death means changing the body. We have already discussed this point. No. But that janma, that birth, it is stated here that it is a bondage. Janma bandha. Bandha means bondage. Practically there is similarity. It is called bandha. And in English, bandha. There is a similarity of sound. Janma bandha. So, this janma, so long your mind will be absorbed in the activities of this material world, you are sure to take birth again. So that activities by intelligence have to be purified in such a way that it will not affect you. It will not affect you. That is the tactic. This tactic. So, we should be very serious. that many lives we have passed, but there was no opportunity to get out of the stimulation of birth, death, old age and diseases. Now here is a chance. Here is a chance in the human form of life. So every intelligent man should take advantage of it, and you can get assistance from these authorized books of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, and also expert advice, knowledge. So we should not miss this opportunity. And then the question is, suppose after quitting this body, the present body, I don't get Janma. Then what is happening to me? That is also stated here. Janmabandha vinin mukta padam gacchanti anamayam. Anamayam, amayam means contamination. So, this contaminated life, as soon as we give up this contaminated life, then our promotion is in the uncontaminated atmosphere, anamayam. Anamayam. Anamayam means Vaikuntha. Vaikuntha means where there is no anxiety. I think about this anxiety we explained to you in our last meeting. So we are getting promotion. We are getting promotion to a life where there is no birth, no death, and no disease, no old age. And that means we come to our normal life. Normally we want. Nobody wants disease. Nobody wants death. Nobody wants old age. Nobody wants to suffer the miseries of birth. Oh, there are great miseries when you are in the womb of the mother, all tightly packed up and in a bag, suffocated bag. We do not know how do we leave it. And if we put again into that position, it will be very difficult. You cannot leave for 3 seconds. By the arrangements of nature or God, we live within the womb of our mother for 10 months in that position. But we have forgotten. But just imagine in how much trouble I was. That is these things that we thought. That is intelligence thought. Now, here is a chance that you can get rid of these, all these miseries. The miseries of birth, the miseries of death, the miseries of old age, miseries of disease. Now we are speaking the synopsis. The Bhagavad Gita, this second chapter, is the synopsis, what will be elaborately explained. Not very elaborately, but still more clearly it will be explained in later chapter. Now, Bhagavad Gita is the preliminary study of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Just like introductory study. Now, how we can practically get into such activities which will not bound me, in the reaction. That is explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam, that sabai punsa paro dharma jato bhakti radho khaji. Atma means self. Our present position is that we are not happy. We are always full of anxiety. That is our present position. Now here, just the opposite word is used, that jaya atma suprasidati. If you want actually to make yourself jolly, full of happiness, then you should search out your occupation in such a way that will lead you to the devotional service of the Supreme Lord. Savai punsa paro dharma. Paro means the highest or the transcendent. We are engaged in some sort of activity. Nobody is free from activity. Even an ant, it is also engaged in activity. And the elephant, ant is the most, and according to our vision, the ant is very small and the elephant is very big. But everyone, beginning from the ant up to the elephant, so far our experience is concerned, there are other big animals also. We have not seen. But we can see from the description of the scripture that there are fishes in the ocean which is called Timingal. The Timingal, and perhaps you know that fish which is called in Sanskrit Tini Matsa or whale fish, very big. It is sometimes 100 feet long. So there are other fishes, which is a Timingal. That fish swallows up this fish, this 100 feet long. Now just imagine what must be this length of that fish's body. So in God's creation there are so many wonderful things, we have not seen all, but everyone is engaged in some sort of occupation for livelihood. Nobody is silent. Nobody is silent. According to his nature, modes of nature and position, everyone is busy. Now, the Bhagavad says that savai punsa paro dharma, everyone is busy. But when one is busy in such a work that leads to devotional service of the Lord, that busyness, that occupation is the supermost. That occupation is the supermost. Savai punsa paro dharma. Paro means supermost. And that sort of occupation should be without any cause. Everything is done. So far our duties are concerned, there is a cause. I do this because I want this. So there is a cause and effect. But this sort of business, this sort of occupation, which leads you to the devotional service of the Lord, it has no cause. It has no cause. Why it has no cause? Just like a lover, or say lover, beloved, set aside, just like mother. A mother loves her child. There is no cause. She does not know why I am loving. Automatically, she loves. Similarly, we have got our relationship with the Supreme Consciousness. We are consciousness. That is accepted. Now, there is Supreme Consciousness also. Just let us have some estimation. What is the Supreme Consciousness? Now, Supreme Consciousness is described in the Bhagavad Gita, Jena Sarvam Idam Tatam. The consciousness is distributed throughout your whole body. That we can make an experiment. But this consciousness is not having to spread over all the cosmic manifestations. That is also a fact. My consciousness is spread over my body. your consciousness is spread over your body. I do not know what you are thinking now, and you do not know what I am thinking. Therefore, my consciousness is individual, your consciousness is individual. But there is the super soul who knows what you are thinking and what I am thinking, what he is thinking, everyone thinks. That is super consciousness. So, super consciousness and individual consciousness. So, our relationship, the super consciousness and the individual consciousness is eternal. Eternal. There cannot be, separation. Therefore, my position is just like there is superior one and the inferior one. Inferior one is subordinate to the superior one, and inferior one is to act according to the superior one. Just like it is thought here that Krishna is the super consciousness. He is trying to convince Arjuna that you act according to my direction. Because you are individual consciousness subordinate to me, and I am super consciousness. And in the last phase of Bhagavad Gita, you will see that he summarized, Lord Krishna summarized, the sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam saranam. You just surrender. This is the summary substance of everything. So, therefore, the conclusion is that the individual consciousness should surrender to the supreme consciousness and act accordingly. That is the position of standing on the conscious plane. That is the position of conscious plane. And Srimad Bhagavata also says, the sabai punsa paro dharma, the activities, the occupation, the business, that which leads us to that consciousness, that I am subordinate to the supreme consciousness, and let me act according to the supreme consciousness. Without any cause, why I shall act? There is no such question. It is automatic. Automatic. Just like little son and the mother. The little son is automatically subordinate to the mother. Whatever the mother says, the child acts, the mother is completely dependent. Similarly, as soon as we make our consciousness completely engaged in the service of the supreme consciousness, that is our liberated position. That is our liberated position. And in that liberated position, whatever we do, there is no reaction. That is transcendental position. So what Sri Krishna says here, that karmajam, that any work which you are performing, that is creating some reaction for future enjoyment or suffering. But if you act intelligently, in collaboration with the supreme consciousness, you will be free from this bondage of birth, death, old age and diseases. And in your next life, this is a training period. This life will be a training period. And as soon as you are fully trained up, then the next result will be that after giving up this body, you come to my kingdom. Taptadeham punajjanma naiti mameti kaunte. So this is the whole part. That sort of business which will lead us to the position when we shall be adopted. We shall be adopted in the supreme consciousness. Just like this morning I was giving an example. Just like one motor car is passing on in 60 miles speed, and a cyclist also going on. If the cyclist catches the motor car, he can also proceed with the same speed, 60-mile speed, without even paddling. Similarly, if we can join our consciousness with the Supreme Consciousness, then our whole life becomes successful. That is the point. Now, how to join it? The religion. This whole worldly religious process is the same, experimental or formulas or rituals, so that one may become adopted with the Supreme Consciousness. Every religion. If we become attracted by the rituals only, or formulas, and quarrel on that point, that, oh, my Bible says like this, and I say, no, my Veda says like this. The Muslim says that, no, my Quran says like this, your is not right. Then we become attached to the rituals only. We forget the right point. The right point is, the whole process is, how to dovetail myself with the Supreme Consciousness. Going to the church, it is not a formality, but the real thing is to elevate myself gradually, to dovetail myself to the Supreme Consciousness of God. That is the real formula. Krishna says that karmajam bhukdhijukta, when we are engaged in such a way, then we get rid of this janamandra minimum. And next sloka is jadate mohakalila dantashi nidvedam sotabvasasutasya. When you are elevated to that platform, dovetailing yourself with the Supreme Consciousness, then there is no more requisition for understanding the scriptures or the rituals or the religious process. You are transcendental to that. All these paraphernalia. Jadade mohakalinam buddhidvati tarishyati. When your consciousness is dovetailed in cooperation with the Supreme Consciousness, then you are transcendental to the position of this illusory stage. Jadate mohakalinam buddhidvati tarishyati sadadantasi nidveda. At that time, you become callous to all this ritual, because your position and your activities are fixed. Sotabhasa sutasa. Whatever you have heard and whatever you have to hear in the future, all things. Therefore, the whole thing depends how to adjust ourselves to that Supreme Consciousness. And if we cannot, the next verse in the Srimad Bhagavat says, the dhanna samishtita punsha visakshena kathasuja no padayavati jadi samayavahi kevalam. If by performing all religious rituals very nicely and very perfectly, if we fail to dovetail ourselves with the Supreme Consciousness, then all our labor for performing these rituals and religious performances, they become only labor of love. It has not produced anything substantial. Nano nistamani karmani kudbuta me. This is the question about you, that when I shall be self-realized by doing work without any fruitful result, so what will be the position of my self-realization? In answer to that question, that when you shall be callous to all religious rituals and scriptural injunctions, and simply you shall be engaged in the God-filling business of with the super consciousness, then you are in transcendental position of all religious rituals and all conception of religious ceremonies and everything. But in the beginning, you require all these things. Therefore, Bhagavad says that sort of religion which elevates you to that consciousness, that is the supreme type of religion. Sutibhi pratipannate jalasthasati nishchala samadhu achala buddhi sada yogam avasati. This is the position of yoga. Yoga, samadhi. Samadhi means to be always in the situated, in the super consciousness, situated in the business of job training with the super consciousness. That is called samadhi, Bhagavad Gita. Sutivi vidipannasi, yada asana nishchala. You are not defeated. Even by hearing so many other things, if you are not defeated, then that position is called samadhi, and that position is the highest position of your life. Now, Krishna is being questioned by Arjuna that what are the symptoms of such person who is already in that position of dovetailing the individual consciousness with the super consciousness. What are the symptoms? Arjuna vāca, sita pragdasyata bhāsa samādhi sasya kesava sita dhi kim prabhāsita kimāsita vṛjita kim. Now, Arjuna says, my dear Krishna, will you kindly explain what are the language, how a person who is already in transcendental position, how does he speak, how does he act, and how does he live, how does he move, all these things, because in our present life, we have to act. Activities not stop, simply the activities are to be adopted in a certain way that we can join ourselves with the super consciousness. Now, when such thing is performed, when actually one is adopted with the super consciousness, what are the symptoms of his life? This is being questioned by Arjuna. And Lord Krishna, Sri Bhagavan was. You will find always in Bhagavad Gita that although Krishna is speaking and the word Bhagavan is used, because Krishna is Krishna, that very word means the supreme personality of Godhead. Just like we have recited the slok, Ishara Parama Krishna Sachidananda Vigraha Anadi Radi Govinda Sarvakarana Karanam. So Krishna and Bhagavan is identical. So here you see in the Bhagavad Gita, instead of mentioning that Krishna says, when Arjuna is speaking, it is clearly said that Arjuna says, but when Krishna is speaking, it is said, see, Bhagavan Upasana, the personality of God is speaking. Now, Sri Krishna answering the symptoms of the self-realized personality. So, what is that first symptom is, prajahati jada kaman sarvan partha manogatan atmani eva atmana tushta sthita pragnasta ruchyati. The first principle of, the first symptom of a self-realized soul is that he does not make any plan for his prosperity. Because we are always busy in making plans. Now, after this, we shall do this. After this, we shall do this. But one who is self-realized, he has no plan, because he has dotted himself with the Supreme Consciousness, so for himself he has nothing to do. He simply depends. He simply depends on the Supreme Consciousness. It is very elevated state, you see, that completely he surrenders himself and but we should not be, imitating this. This is, of course, spoken for the high state. But we should, without coming to that high state, we should not imitate. Okay. Krishna is asked, he must give the proper answer. So he is giving the answer that prajahati jata kaman sarvan partha manogata. Because our mind is the factory of creating so many plans. So many plans. But one who has dogged himself, he has nothing to do for plan making, because everything is taken up by the Supreme Consciousness. He has simply to follow. Therefore he has, for himself, he has no plan. He has no plan. This is the first thing. But without reaching that state, and we should not pose ourselves that I have nothing to think, I have nothing to think of future, past, everything. No, gradually we shall come to the state when there will be everything done automatically. But in the present moment, we should give up plan making. But we shall have to take up the plan of the Supreme Consciousness. Personally, we shall not make any plan, but we have to receive the plan from the Supreme Consciousness. That will be our position. Just like an apprentice, he is working in the apprenticeship, he should not present his own plan, but he has to take plans of work from his superior. Then he will learn. And when he is accustomed, when he is elevated, then he will be able to make independent plans, not independent always, but even if he is higher officer, everyone has to consult the higher authority. Similarly, this means that I shall not independently make any plan, but I must accept the standard plan which is coming directly from the Supreme Consciousness through a channel. You have to seek that channel. So that channel is called, you will find it in the Bhagavad Gita, in the fourth chapter, parampara. Parampara, disciplic succession. Disciplic succession. The words, the plan and the instruction which is coming directly from Krishna, that thing we have to accept. We shall not make any our own plan. That is the way of making progress. Now, these disciplic successions, as we have accepted, this disciplic succession comes from Krishna. Just like Krishna is instructing Arjuna. Krishna is instructing Arjuna. And we have to understand how Arjuna has understood Krishna. And if we follow the understanding of Arjuna, then we are following the parampara system or the disciple system. That is the problem. Now in the 10th chapter, you will find that how Krishna is understood by Arjuna. After hearing, at least 75% of the instruction of Bhagavad Gita, the estimation of Arjuna is stated in the 10th chapter. He says that, I think, Yes. Arjuna, after understanding Krishna, after his instruction, he said that automatically he said, Param Brahma Param Dhamma Pavitram Param Bhavan Purusam Sasatam Vibham Adi Devam Ajam Vibham. Krishna, now I understand it that you are Param Brahma. Param Brahma means the supreme spiritual identity. Every one of us is Brahma. You are Brahma, I am Brahma. Every living entity is Brahma. Because he is not this matter, he is spirit, soul. Whoever he is spirit, soul, he is called Brahma. But Krishna is addressed here, Param Brahma. Just like we recited that sloka, the verse, Ishara Parama Krishna. Ishara, every one of us, Ishara, the translation of Ishara word is God. The God, God means, Ishara means controller. So every one of us is controller. But Krishna is the supreme controller. He has no controller. I am controller. I am Brahma. But at the same time, I have got superior controller over me. But Krishna is called Param Brahma or the Ishara Parama, the supreme controller, because he has no controller over him. And that is the acceptance of Arjuna. This is the mode of studying Bhagavad Gita. If we don't interpret in our own way, if we really want to study Bhagavad Gita, then here is the confirmation by Arjuna how he understands Krishna. After hearing Bhagavad Gita. Not only that, he also, in the 11th chapter, he finds that Arjuna will request Krishna to show him his gigantic universal form. Because he, Arjuna as he accepted Krishna that he is God undoubtedly. But in future, people may think that Krishna and Arjuna were two friends. So, out of friendly appreciation, Arjuna might have accepted Krishna as the supreme personality of Godhead. But what is the evidence to us? Now, here, when Krishna, Arjuna requested that Krishna, you kindly show me the gigantic form, the gigantic universal form, he showed. That is also described. So, the idea is that imitation God, there may be so many. Nowadays it has become a fashion, and not in your country, at least in India, it has become a fashion that everyone is coming out and he declares himself, I am God. I am God. As if the God has become a very cheap thing and it can be had in the market, wherever you go. That is not the thing. God is not so cheap. God is not so cheap thing. The description of God, he is in the Brahma Samhita, he is given. Jasaika nishasita kalama thavalamma jivanti loma vilaja jagadanna natha Vishnu mahanusaya jasa kalavisisu govindamadi parisam tamaham bhajami. The God, this material creation, we have got this information from authoritative scripture. This material creation, how it is being done? It is being done that the Supreme Lord, in His form of Mahavishnu, is lying on the causal ocean and in His sleeping mode and with the breathing of His nostrils, so many universes are being born. Seat. And when he is taking the breathing, inhaling, the whole thing is going into him. So such is the position of God, that by his breathing, all the universes are coming, and by his breathing, so the existence of this universe means within his breathing field, within the breathing field of the Mahavishnu. So that Mahavishnu is described, jasaikanishasitakalamathavalamba jivanti lomabilajagadandanatha Vishnu mahamsayajasya kalavishasa. That Mahavishnu is also plenary portion of Krishna, Govinda. That Mahavishnu is also not the original. The original personality of God is Krishna. So, this is a great science. What Krishna is? Krishna science. It is simply a synopsis. Bhagavad Gita is only a synopsis of the science of God. And it is not explicitly given in the Srimad Bhagavat. But after all, it is a great science. And if we study it very seriously, then we can understand. We should not take so cheaply that here is a God, here is a God, here is a God. No, God is not so cheap. God is one and He is great. God is great, as in the English language it is said. And nobody can be greater than Him or equal to Him. That is the position of God. Now here, Arjuna, he accepts Krishna and he says that you are Parabrahma. Parabrahma, Param Dhamma. Dhamma means in which everything rests. We are resting. Everything is resting, just like this is scientific and practical, you know, that the innumerable planets that you can see at night as luminary stars in the stars, each and every one of them, more or less, they are all different kinds of planets. But do you know how they are floating in the space? They are floating on the sun, on the sun rays. That's not that you can see. Similarly, the sunshine is the initiation of the Brahma Jyoti that is coming out of the body of the Supreme Lord. So everything is resting on the sign of the Supreme Lord. That's what is called Param Dhamma. Param Dhamma means everything resting on you. Param Bhamma, Param Dhamma, Pavitram. Pavitram means uncontaminated. Because we, although we are Brahma, now we are contaminated by this material body. But the Lord has no contaminated body of this material existence. We have already noted, Ishvara Parama Krishna Satchidananda, Satchidananda Vigraha. Satchidananda Vigraha means his body is full of bliss, full of knowledge, and it is eternal. That is completely distinct from this body. So when there is description of the Lord, that he is formless means he is not of this form. He has got a Satchidananda Vigraha, a different element. Therefore, he is called Pavitra and Paramam Bhama. You are the supreme original. Purusam Shastatam Vidyam Adi Devam Ajam Vibham. So, you are Purus. Purus means enjoyer. In the Vedic literature, about yourself. Ahustam Vishayu Sarva. All the greatest sages accept you, the supreme Lord. Ahustam Vishayu Sarva. Devarsi Narada, Devarsi Narada. I have already spoken to you about Narada. He has also accepted. That means authority. He is quoting authority. Not that. I am personally accepting you as such. But there are many authorities. Many authorities. So, we have to understand about the science of God from the extraordinary activities and confirmed by the authorities, accepted by the revealed scripture, then we have to accept, you see. Not blind. So Arjuna is giving such evidence, you see. Asito devalam braka svayam chaiva bravisime. You are accepted by such authorities like that, and I have the opportunity that I hear all these from you directly. I am fortunate enough that I am become your related in friendship with you, and I am hearing. So here is the evidence. Now, if you want to study Bhagavad Gita, then you have to accept all this, this statement of Arjuna. Because Bhagavad Gita was explained directly to Arjuna. And if you don't accept the appreciation of the direct person who heard Bhagavad Gita, then whom do you believe? Suppose I have heard something directly from one person, so what I am saying, another person who has no direct relation, he is also saying, whom would you believe? You have to believe the person who has directly heard. So here, there is no doubt about it, that Arjuna directly heard Krishna, and his appreciation are recorded here. So therefore, if we want to study Bhagavad Gita, then we have to accept the appreciation of the direct hearer, Arjuna. If you do that, then we can get the right thing. But if you change it for our ulterior motive, as so many annotators are doing in the case of Bhagavad Gita, then we shall not be able to understand what is Bhagavad Gita. All right.